Keep your eyes open for lots of events in the month of October. Also, it looks like Frankie is in need of candy.
Yes. 3 months of tears.
Please see Frankie for any questions about baptism or membership. And just as a reminder, we have the restrooms downstairs through the community hall. And we have hot drinks in the back with everything that you need. Is there any other announcements this morning?
Yes. Just the whole candy thing is on October 31st, while trick-or-treating is happening, we have a humongous hot dog giveaway. We probably see about 200 people give away a bunch of hot dogs, and we like to give away candy too, so that's what the candy is for. It's not really for Frankie, it's for the kids.
I'm gonna be good.
Excuse me, I have an announcement. Oh, can I go next?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. For those who have noticed that I'm smiling a lot more this morning than I usually do, I went to the eye doctor on Thursday, and my prayer before I went was that my vision wouldn't get any worse. Astoundingly, he said, you're one step away from driving again. I'm going to be able to read, I'm going to be able to drive, I'm going to be able to see your faces, which I can't now. I'll see the fretboard on my base, and beyond my wall, I didn't even think of praying for that eye. So God is great. God is great.
announcement, I think we'll turn to the scripture. God again set a certain day. This he did when a long time later he spoke through David.
As in the passage already quoted.
Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. Thank you.
So at this time, offering has provided for you an opportunity to give back your time, talent, or your money. There's a basket in the back, and also on Facebook, you can donate. But Zechariah chapter 12, verse 1 says, a prophecy, the word of the Lord concerning Israel. The Lord who stretches out the heavens, who lays the foundation of the earth, and who forms the human spirit within a person, declares. And so, talking about offering and all the money that you have and all the physical things that you have, they're all God's. You know, he made it all. He owns it all. And so we're just good stewards of it. And if we're going to be good stewards of it, we have to acknowledge that he is God over all, over the human spirit, over the things of this earth, and we want to give back, not just financially, but also, you know, with your talent and time, because there's a lot of things that the church can do in the community and for other people. And I'm just we're very blessed to have a leadership and a direction of this church that we help other people. And it's not all ours. It's supposed to be shared. And if you would like to give, that would be great at this time. And so transitioning to that, from that to praying, because we lay everything in God's feet, our physical, our mental, our emotional, and our spiritual, definitely. And so if there's any prayer requests, we can take those now. I don't have a pen. Is that a pen? I don't know. First time in a long time, I've never had it. It's going to snow. I mean, don't
say it. Yeah.
Pray for Frankie never to say yes, right? Okay. I need prayer requests. Yes?
Prayer requests for our elderly family member.
Anything else? Yes.
Close family friend, oldest son was just diagnosed with stage 4 pancreatic cancer. And another friend recently was diagnosed with metastatic liver cancer. They're both very young. We need lots of prayers and we need miracles.
Yes. Anything else? Yeah.
That a certain business coming to Culver will not.
We'll leave that up to God's will. That's why we're praying about it. Anything else? Yes?
Just for safe travels for you, you're going to appear this week.
My cousin of 46 died a week and a half ago, and he didn't plug himself in. He has had a, what do you call it?
Mechanical
heart or something. His last breath in his sleep and passed away. So I'll be traveling Wednesday, funeral's Thursday, and traveling back on Friday. So just pray for me and the family. Anything else? Yes?
My friend, co worker, pray for her and her family's salvation. Her husband, who also worked with us, was wrongfully terminated. And they're going through a lot right now, and she's struggling.
Is there anything we can do financially or help her?
No, her parents have stepped in, and it's emotional, and he wasn't expecting it because he is a by the book person who follows the rules, and it just came out of the blue. Because the woman who did it, it was a witch hunt kind of thing.
Well, we'll keep praying for that. Anything else?
Yes. Safe travels for Josiah and me. We're heading back to Alaska tomorrow.
few people on the fence who want to go. So hopefully we'll get a good group of six to go. And I'm the leader, for some reason they put me as a leader. No. Anything else? All right, well, John, let's go. God, I'm praying. God, we thank you that we could pray to you and talk to our Father in heaven. And God, thank you so much for the Holy Spirit to connect us to you through Jesus. And God, we know sometimes we don't know what to say. Holy Spirit groaned for us and says it to you. A lot of times we see pain in others, especially physical pain, cancer, and diseases or sickness. And it hurts us in our hearts to see them go through that. But we pray that they will seek Jesus in those times and draw closer to you and not further away. That we may be the light and give them hope through Jesus Christ. And God, we pray for the doctors, give them wisdom and understanding. And we, even if things don't go our way, God, we do trust in you. And, if the cancer's still there or people pass away, we know that you are still in control. There's always a reason for everything that you do. But we put these things at your feet and ask for your will to be done. Because if it was up to us, everything would be wonderful. But because of sin, because of hurt or pain in this world, we are longing for the day that we are with you always. That we won't have any crying or pain or darkness or sin. But until then, our bodies suffer and we get old and we have cancer and things that hurt our body. But we can come to the great physician and heal us. And if not, your will is still done. And God, I pray that you will put your Holy Spirit in the people that need it so they can have a different outlook in life that's not all about the physical, but God, it's about what's happening after we pass from this life. That will last far longer than when we are on earth. I pray that we are prepared for that, that if we're not, that we put faith in Jesus. And that we may walk with you daily, and that we may love others and love you more. God, we thank you for those who have been healed physically also, and especially Ed, and we just praise for your answering prayers in that direction, and that you're going to use him for a great purpose, for giving him those things. But I know his heart, even if he did not get those things, he would still praise. And that is a light to me and an encouragement to me also. That we can have a spiritual outlook on things and not just the physical. God, we pray for family members and people who are hurting and health issues. And God, also travel. We know that Leela and Josiah are very special to us. And thank you for their life. And I pray that I have safe travels also. And those who are traveling from here back home, some people are an hour away or longer, just to come to be with the family of God. We just thank you for them and pray that they can be safe and keep them safe. God, I pray for your will to be done on those who are coming in for business and things that are in flux or in a capacity that we can't control, but you can. And God, we pray that you will use your will to be done. And maybe we need to reach out to them and help them spiritually. God, I pray for those who are going to Guatemala and they prepare their hearts now. And we thank you for the people who are stepping up to go there. It's a rough trip, but it's a good trip that we can put our faith in you and trust you and not the things around us. I pray that you will increase our faith, increase our prayer of life and our love for you. God, we pray that Erica's co-worker, that you may help them and bring them to understanding of what they're going through, and all of us who are persecuted or falsely accused, that we may call it blessed and have a blessing on that. God, that we may grow closer to each other and to you. We thank you for letting us pray, and that we may do this all in Jesus' name, and not in our name, not in our righteousness, not in our time, but in your name, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Let's stand together. So we start standing, and if you want to sit down, if you want to clap, if you want to raise your hands, if you want to pray, if you want to listen, all those are those. Just do it between you and God. Don't worry about anybody else.
You are peace in my troubled sea. Amen.
Thank you.
us has been in
creation.
Thank you, Jesus.
Glory. Just lift up the name. There's no other name on this earth that is so strong and so powerful.
Amen.
We just want to be your Lord.
Thank you.
between the things you face every day and during the week, and Satan trying to beat you up, and then you come here and I'm crying all over the place. Okay, alright, good. All right. I cry too much, that's what Katie says. That's okay. So we're going through the books of the Bible, Genesis through Revelation, and finding that Jesus is in every book. He was prophesied in every book in the Old Testament. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John saw him in their different perspectives. Just like when you look at a diamond, there's different perspectives, but it's still the same diamond. And so you don't want all the witnesses to be exactly the same, because then they rehearse their story. And no court on this in America would ever have four witnesses, and they all have the same story. They're going to think like, they cheated somewhere. And so in different perspectives to see how Jesus lived, and then Jesus died, resurrected, and he's back at the Father in my hand, has all authority in heaven. And then the apostles disseminated his word, and we get the New Testament, or the New Covenant, or the New Promise, and it's all pointing towards Jesus and the way he wants to see things. And then Revelation says he's coming back.
Yes!
They touched it. Oh! Anyway. So, Zechariah, so we have Zechariah and Malachi, two last prophets of the Old Testament. And Zechariah means God remembers. Isn't that interesting? But his name, a lot of names in the Old Testament meant something, and each name brought about either God's direction or looking towards Jesus. And Zechariah meant that. And so he was devoted by spreading the word of God. And of the approximately 86 billion neurons in the human brain, 100 to 1,000 of synapses associated with it, trillions of messages are continuously sent and received. Within these synapses, the SciLab has discovered that proteins grow together to support the maintenance of memory. Our brain is a very interesting thing. Here's the thing about the brain, too. We love our memories, right? Okay. The good thing about memories is that we have them. The bad thing is that we remember what? The bad times, too. We can't, like, flush through down the toilet. The physical substance of memory storage, termed functional amyloid, is a perfect rendering of the amyloids associated with the brain diseases and memory loss. And so, in my family, it runs, Alzheimer's runs in my family. And so that's why I'm constantly trying to be with my mind, trying to do word puzzles and talk and do all kinds of things, because my mind, I don't want it to go to waste. I saw my grandmother with Alzheimer's for 11 years, and she was like 86 pounds before she passed away. But it's not a really good thing to have. We don't like talking about that. We don't like talking about our memory loss or the things that we don't remember. But the cool thing is God remembers, and he also forgets. I don't know how that happens. But he says when we come to Jesus and we have faith in him, we follow what he tells us to do, and our faith is with him, he forgets our sins as far as the east is from the west. So if you keep going east, will you ever go west? No. And so as far as the east is from the west, our sins are gone. He forgets them. And so he remembers the good through Jesus Christ. And so God remembers his people through the branch of David. And the one who would be pierced for us and the world. In Zechariah, he says Jesus is the branch of David and the one pierced for us. Look at Hebrews chapter 4, verse 7. God again said a certain day, calling it, what does he call it? Today. This he did when a long time later he spoke to David, as in the passage already quoted. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. And so I'm asking you to open your heart and let the Holy Spirit change it. Not me, not my words, not the things that I'm going to do or say, but God's Holy Spirit changes. And everybody's welcome, but you are not going to stay the same if you encounter Jesus Christ, the holy and living Savior. And so Zechariah was pointing to the one who is going to die for us and come back to life. He was pointing to the one who was the branch, and now, as children of God, with Christ, we are grafted back in to the branch. That's a really cool picture, because I love my plants. If Katie touches them, they usually die. But I love my plants. And the interesting thing is, I could take a shoot of a plant and cut a little bit off of it, cut a little hole in the other side, put tape around it, and it will grow out of that side. I grafted it in. And so, when we have the Gentiles and the people who are not a Jew, God said with Jesus that he will take the Gentiles who have faith in him and graft them back into the branch. Isn't that amazing? That God has this analogy of a branch and a living organism. And the church is living. It is not dead. You see a lot on TV that the church is dead, that God is dead, that no, it's not. That's a falsehood. That is a lie from the devil. Mm-hmm. The church is alive and well because Jesus is sitting at the right hand of God.
Amen.
And so Revelation 22, 16 through 17 says this, I, Jesus, have sent my angel to give you this testimony for the churches. And who are the churches?
We love you.
The people. Okay? It's not a building. I am the root and the offspring of David and the bright and morning star. The spirit of the bride says, come, and let the one who hears says, come. Let the one who is thirsty come, and let the one who wishes to take the free gift of the water of life. And that's Jesus Christ. And so, we're going to get into Zechariah here, and he's going to be teaching us. And see, I don't think the people picked it up. Because they were thinking physical. There was physical laws, there was physical things you had to do, there was physical temple, there was physical sacrifices. They were looking towards the spiritual, but we now, on the other side of the cross, can hook to the spiritual and say, oh, that's what they were talking about. It's awesome to see Jesus throughout the Old Testament. So here we go. Jesus is the branch. Zechariah chapter 3, verse 7 through 9. This is what the Lord Almighty says, if you will walk in, what? Obedience to me and my requirements, keep my requirements, then you will govern my house and have charge of my courts, and I will give you a place among the standing here. Listen, High Priest Joshua, you and your associates seated before you, you are men symbolic of things to come. Even God says it right there. You are symbolic or a symbol of things to come. I'm going to bring my servant, the branch. Wonder why it's capitalized. See the stone I have set in front of Joshua. There are seven eyes on that one stone. Now, were there literally seven eyes? No. Spiritually, what does seven mean?
Perfect.
Perfect or perfection. And the eyes, he can see everything. And I will engrave an inscription on it, says the Lord Almighty, and I will remove the sin of this land in a single day. What day is that in history? He took the sacrifices of all people on the cross. He's done everything to get us to God, except force us. And we have a choice to have faith in Jesus. We are not forced. By no means. Now, does God want everybody to come? Yes. That's why he's patient with us. That's why we're not dead yet. That's why we're still breathing. So we can have the opportunity to come to the branch. The living branch. The one who is going to be there forever. We're not going to be here forever. Our spirit will live on. And hopefully it is with the branch. Hopefully it's not thrown in the fire. Hopefully, it's not picking up the sticks and the chaff and throwing it in the fire. Which, there's something about fire, isn't there? When you look at it, it's like alive. It's like weird. And Dean said that actually the wood is not burning itself. It's a chemical reaction. It's actually the flames above the wood. What was that name?
Pyrolysis.
Ooh, that's cool. The more I'm with Dean, the more I learn about fire. Anyway, not that I like fire, right? So when we come to Jesus, he burns away the chaff. He burns away those things are in us that the shame and the guilt and the things that we struggle with that we cannot get away with. that we can't get out of our lives. Jesus does that. And so instead of throwing us in the fire, he grafts us back in through Jesus Christ. And so when we're in Jesus, here's Zechariah saying Jesus administrates justice, mercy, compassion, and the Holy Spirit. Zechariah was even pointing to the Holy Spirit here. Look at this. Zechariah chapter 7, 8 through 12. I encourage you to read the whole book of Zechariah. It's a pretty long one. But it just points so directly to Jesus. And the word of the Lord came again to Zechariah. This is what the Lord Almighty said. Administer true justice. How do you have true justice? You have to have a foundation that doesn't move. And who determines right and wrong? It's not us. It's not the laws of the land. It's not a constitution. Who determines the law? God. And then we can go from there and say, okay, this is right and this is wrong, and here's the justice based on him, not us. We always change. Oh my goodness. I mean, one year you think apples are good for you, and the next year they say they're bad for you. Or bacon. I mean, I heard one time that bacon was good for you, and now it's bad for you again. I'm not sure what to do. I'm just getting bacon. Maybe bacon wrapped apples. Maybe we'll do that. Anyway.
Oh, yeah.
So Zechariah here saying, look, administer true justice. The only way to have true justice is to have absolute truth. And absolute truth is only lies in Jesus Christ. And to do that, you need to show mercy. We're not all about judgment. God is. But we need to show mercy. Because God has shown mercy on us. And compassion to one another. Do not oppress the widow or the fatherless, the foreigner or the poor. Do not plot evil against each other. But they refused to pay attention. Stubbornly, they turned their backs and covered their ears. You know what they did, right? When you're teaching somebody about Jesus, I've seen a lot of people go like, don't plot here. Nope. That's what they're doing. Zechariah's like, how many years did Israel do this? And they failed. And you're doing it the same way again. We do that a lot of times, don't we? Well, I don't like that part of the Bible. I'm not going to believe in that. Oh, well, I'll change it with the culture. Oh, no, I just ripped that page. Oh, no, I just left. What does it say in Revelation when you change the word of God? You're going to have double the plagues that was taught in Revelation. Don't change it. Jesus established it. It is true. But they refuse to pay attention. Stubbornly, they turned their backs and covered their ears. They made their hearts as hard as flint and would not listen to the law or to the words that the Lord Almighty had sent by his, what? Spirit. Through the earlier prophets. So the Lord Almighty was very angry. You know why? Because they didn't listen to the history of their ancestors. They didn't say, wait a minute, they did wrong. God disciplined them. They went to exile. They got that, they listened to God, and it was good for like hundreds of years. They're like, oh, we can do it ourselves. Oh, we'll just follow these gods over here, and we'll forget this God who did all that. Isn't it funny how our memory works? Oh, well, we could do that again because they did it wrong. That doesn't make sense. If the history says that this is wrong and they failed, just because you're doing it doesn't mean it's gonna work. What's the definition of insanity? Doing the same thing over and over again and, yeah, thinking it's the same result. That's insane. We do the same thing. Oh, Jesus didn't really say that. This culture did it and they were fine. You're sure about that? Every culture that did that failed. And oh, but we can do it differently. Hello? If you don't learn your history, you're due to what? Okay. See, we know that, but we don't know if actually practice that. And they made their hearts hard, and they said, oh, we know better than Jesus. We know better than God. We know better, and we're going to do what we want. You think an earthly father would be so happy that their son and daughter did something totally different and hardened their heart and never came home? No, you'd be angry. I would be angry if my kids did that. But he wants them to come back, so he's a God of compassion and patience. Because Zechariah 12, 1 says here that Jesus owns everything. Okay. A prophecy of the word of the Lord concerning Israel, the Lord who stretches out the heavens, who lays the foundation of the earth. Who laid the foundation of the earth? God. Okay, good. I just thought we were on the same page here. And who forms the human spirit within a person. Zechariah 12, 10. And I will pour out on the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem a spirit of grace and supplication. Grace is, we don't deserve it, but he gives us anyway, and he gives us more power than we deserve. And supplication is praying for those in our life and praying for God to help. They will look on me, the one they have pierced. Who are they talking about? And they will mourn for him as one mourns for an only child, and grieve bitterly for him as one grieves for a firstborn son. Jesus owns everything. It's always interesting to me that Jesus died on a cross that he made the wood for, that all the way back in creation he spoke for, and he died on something he made. The nails he made himself. The crown of thorns he made himself. And we turn it to evil and crucify the Son of God. Isn't it interesting when humans touch something, it goes awry? When God touches something, it changes. Jesus owned everything. So if we have this whole mindset that Jesus owns everything, and we don't, and Jesus is God, and we're not God, doesn't that change the whole perspective of life? Well, maybe I shouldn't be so busy with this. Maybe I shouldn't be spending my money on this. Maybe I shouldn't be watching this, because if this body is God's, then we should be praising him with everything. Not just Sunday for an hour, 20 minutes. 11:55, better yet. Last point. So if Jesus owns everything, Let's work this backwards. Jesus owns everything because he's justice and mercy and compassion as the Holy Spirit, and that he's the branch and we're going to be grafted in. Then we can call him King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He is a Savior. He is a Lord. He is a King. He is the ruler. He is the one who helps the soul. He's the one that gives us a new spirit and a new name and a new purpose and a new love. And so if he's your king, you better be following him. Instead of only coming into court once a week and saying, okay, I'm good, check. And Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, you're doing whatever you want. Because if he's king, then he has to be king over everything, even your sins, even the hidden stuff. Because then the Bible says that we, as Christian to brother to sister, or sister to brother, or brother to brother, or sister to sister, we're supposed to tell each other our sins so we can help each other get better. Not just come to Sunday morning and go, I'm happy, I have no problems, I'm great. And then Monday, oh, I hate you. If Jesus is king, God made him king over everything. Look at Zechariah 14, 6 through 9. On that day, there will be neither sunlight nor cold, frosty darkness. It will be a unique day, a day known only to the Lord. With no distinction between day and night, when evening comes, there will be light. On that day, the living water will flow out from Jerusalem, half of it to the east and the Dead Sea, and half to the west to the Mediterranean Sea, in summer and in winter. The Lord will be king over the whole earth. On that day, there will be one Lord, and his name the only name. Who is that? Jesus Christ. Jesus is flowing day and night. When Jesus hung on the cross and he died, what happened? It became completely dark. There was thunder, there was lightning, there was earthquakes, the dead rose, the temple curtain like ripped. We can get into the Holy of Holies. It was no other day in the world on history that was like that. And the water is flowing from him. The living water. From the east to the west. And he is the king over all the earth. There's only one Lord, and his name is Jesus. And so Zechariah was pointing, Jesus is the branch we need to be grafted into for nourishment and spiritual health. Jesus is the one who has true justice and mercy and compassion in the Spirit. Jesus is the one who owns everything. So how should we live? And Jesus is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. And Zechariah pointed to the one who is coming again. Guys, be ready. It's coming faster than you think. Now, I don't know the day or time. He didn't tell anybody. Which is good, because if he said, October 1st, Jesus is coming back. If he said that, what would everybody do in the world? Repent on September, whatever. What is it, 29th? I can't think of the days. 30th, thank you. September 30th, everybody would repent, come to Jesus, and then he would come back and everybody would get it. Why did they do that? Because true love is following somebody with faith also. Do you have faith in your spouse that they're going to stay faithful? Yes, hopefully you do. And so, does your spouse force you to love them? No, that would be slavery. Jesus gives us a choice to love him now and have faith. And he's going to be faithful. And so we need to live faithful for him. To be in the branch. To have compassion and mercy and justice. And to acknowledge in our life that he is King of Kings, Lord of Lords, and he owns everything. And so we should act differently. We want everyone to come, but nobody, I promise you, nobody will stay the same if you're in the presence of a holy God. Let's pray. You are amazing, God. You have seen to it to let Zechariah have these words and to bring about a change in our lives, that he was pointing to the branch, the one who was pierced, the one who would die for the sins of the world and resurrect on the third day. Thank you for being so loving and compassionate that you would do all things to get us to you. Now it's our choice to have faith in you and to walk in the presence of Jesus Christ. I pray that we make that decision today and that we may follow you and love others and put ourselves last. We just love you and thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. At this time we have communion. Communion is just a fancy word that says that we're going to think about Jesus and we're in the body of Christ. The body of Christ is the people because people are the church. And we're together thinking about Jesus' death and burial and resurrection. And so the juice represents Jesus' blood and the bread represents his body. And so when we take this, we acknowledge to the world that Jesus died and resurrected. And so in Zechariah chapter 12, verse 10, it says, and I will pour out on the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and supplication. They will look on me and they, the one they have pierced, and they will mourn for him as one mourned for an only child, and grieve bitterly for him as one grieves for a firstborn son. Jesus died. And when we come to communion, it's not something we just do and we get bored with. We should come in the presence of God and say, thank you for your death, or I wouldn't even be with you. We would be pitied among all people if we did not acknowledge Jesus as Christ and died for our sins. And so every Sunday we come and we acknowledge to the world that Jesus is King. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for this time in service that we can get together as the body of Christ, and we would remember the body of Christ also. Your death and your burial and resurrection. We thank you for bringing Jesus. We weep and mourn, but on the third day we rejoice. God, thank you for this time together with our brothers and sisters in Christ. In Jesus' name I pray. If you hold the bread and juice, then after the music, we'll all take it together.
He was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our sins. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. By his wounds we are healed. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our sins. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. By his wounds, we are healed.
Let's stand together. So if you'd like to come to Jesus, come talk to me, come talk to another Christian, come talk to the leadership, read the Bible. It says it right there. We need to have faith in Jesus, and that moves us to do many things. And so the story of Jesus, he came, he died, he rose, he ascended, and he's coming back. And you better be prepared, because the only way you're going to get to heaven is through Jesus. And so, get there. I don't know how else to say it. Put faith in Jesus. He's the way and the truth. And so, and go home and read Zechariah. It's an awesome book. It's really cool. If you don't like reading, go to BibleGateway.com and it will read for you. So there you go. You have no excuse. Just go read or listen to it. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for the people who are here, the people who are looking at Facebook, and those people who are being touched by our actions during the week, that we can be strong in Christ, that we put our spiritual armor, that we are leading a life that is worthy of our calling. And God, thank you so much for letting Zechariah write these things, and that he was worthy of his calling as a prophet. And God, I pray that we will turn to you and just love you more, and to thank you for your grace and your mercy and your compassion and the patience you have with us. God, if I was you, I wouldn't have that much patience, but I'm not God. And you are so patient with us. I pray that we will come to repentance, that we will come to Jesus, and not delay. We just love you and thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Have a great day.